So welcome to 27th lecture. In the previous lecture we saw how to derive element coefficient matrix, some of the entries of the element coefficient matrix in case of quadratic element, right. So first we saw in fact C11, the derivation of C11, diagonal element, and then we also saw that it comes equal to this, which was same as in the linear element, right. And then we also saw that expression. Remember that this originally the expression, this right hand side was same, left hand side there was n1, n2 and n3 here in case of linear, right. Because for linear elements n1 is equal to l1, n2 is equal to l2 and n3 is equal to l3. So, the fundamental formula is this. Incidentally, for linear elements n1 is equal to l1, n2 is equal to l2 and l3 is equal to l3. That is why we had started for linear elements with the same expression with this as n1, n2 and n3, right. Because these are more fundamental area coordinates, right. So, l1 is that P23 divided by total area of triangle. So, that is fundamental. Incidentally, for linear elements n1 is equal to l1, and that is why. Okay, so
now let us see C14 coefficient.
Now, this is coming, this will come different than anyway it is C14. So, in case of linear elements C14 does not exist because it is a 3 by 3 matrix, right. So, now small C14 of any element E is given by this expression, daba n1 by daba x into daba n4 by daba x, similarly in terms of y, derivatives with respect to y, and integrated over the elemental area and 1 over mu. So, daba n1 by daba x we have already derived in the previous, see this we have already derived, right. So, twice l1 p1 upon delta minus p1 upon 2 delta. Now, n4 is 4 times L1 L2. Now, this also we have derived here. N4 is 4 times capital L1 capital L2. Now, dn4 by dx is simply will be this, is it not? Because there are two product of two variables. So, daba dn4 by dx will be this, and dl1 by dx will be p1 upon 2 delta. And dl2 by dx will be p2 upon 2 delta. Just to sort of refresh your memory, I have written l1, our standard expression, and so if you take derivative with respect to x, you will get only y2 minus y3 and that is nothing but p1, right. So, p1 upon 2 delta. Then so we substitute here, so we simplify it further. And then we now have both these expressions. So, then we take product, so you get this. So, further simplification will give this expression. And then now we have to integrate over the elemental area. So, if you integrate and simplify and then invoke this formula, right, then you have here for example, twice p1 square integral L1 L2, right. So, it is like L1 raised to 1 and L2 raised to 1. So, it is 1 factorial plus 0 factorial. So, this is 1, this is 1, is it not? So, 1 factorial into 1 factorial upon, so 1 factorial, 0 factorial is 1, 1 plus 1 plus 0 plus 2, is it not? So, that is why you will get 4 factorial, because you have got L1 into L2, is it not? We have here L1, L2. So, L1 raised to 1, L2 raised to 1. So, 1 factorial, 0 factorial is 1, 1 plus 1 plus 0 plus 2. So, that is why you get 4 factorial and into 2 delta. So, likewise you can do it for the other 3 terms and you get these expressions. Right, and then after simplification, you will find that these two first two terms are getting cancelled, and then after you combine these two terms, you get this as the expression. Similarly, now with respect to y, product of derivatives with respect to y, so then the entire this C14, because this we started with C14, you will get it as this. With of course, I think 1 over mu will come here, right. So, now the boundary, the right hand side matrix which is contributed by the source J. So, now we have here, if you remember in case of linear elements, we had J delta by 3 as the contribution from the source, right. So, here let us see what happens. Now, here B1E, that means with respect to node 1, the J is there throughout the element, right. And now we are actually seeing how do we apportion J at various nodes, right, because we are discretized, we are going from continuous domain to discrete domain, is it not, or discretized domain, I should say, right. So, then you have B1 as J. Double integral n1 dx dy. So, now n1 you substitute twice l1 square minus l1, then you get this after simplification. Again, invoke the same formula. Here now it is l1 raised to 2. So, l small l is 2, m is 0, n is 0. So, it will be 2 factorial upon 4 factorial, right. And then you will find that these two terms get cancelled and this becomes 0. Similarly, B2 and B3 is 0, right. So, that means whenever J is there in case of quadratic element, J does not get apportioned to the main nodes 1, 2, 3, but they get apportioned to middle nodes 4, 5, 6. Now, let us see that. So, B4 will be J double integral N4 dx dy. Now, N4 is 4 L1 L2 and now again 4 J L1. L1 and L2. So, this is L1 raised to 1 and L2 raised to 1. So, 1 factorial into 1 factorial into 0 factorial upon 1 plus 1 plus 0 plus 2 whole factorial. So, that is again 4 factorial into 2 delta, of course, that it comes in that formula. So, this comes J delta by 3. So, B4, B5 and B6 that comes as J delta by 3. Right. So, that means you have any triangular element, quadratic element with nodes at the centers of the three. So, suppose this is 1, 2 and 3 and this is 4, 5 and 6 and suppose you have some J. So, this J gets apportioned to J delta by 3 after discretization, FEM discretization, and that goes, that gets apportioned to this 4, 5, 6 nodes and not 1, 2, 3 in case of quadratic elements, right. So, now we have thus seen the entire procedure for quadratic formulation. By this what we have done, we have derived the entire B matrix at the element level, is it not, because we are talking at element level. Similarly, we have we derived one off diagonal elements of the element coefficient matrix C14. We derived, for an example, we derived one diagonal element C11, right. So, then by doing this, we would have then derived the entire element coefficient matrix, because I just showed you one diagonal element derivation, one off diagonal element derivation. Is it not? C14 we saw and C11 we had seen derivation, and then others can be derived in similar way, and then we also derived the B, small BE, that is the source contribution. So, after doing all this, then the rest of the procedure is same, because then you have to form a global coefficient matrix capital C and capital B, right. and then you have to impose the boundary conditions, and the rest of the procedure is same, right. So then this completes the quadratic formulation. So we will go now to the next topic, that is solution of diffusion equation, that is time harmonic problems. Now these are very common. In fact, most of our electromagnetic devices, they are AC devices, is it not? So time is varying. See, earlier also when we did electrostatic analysis, right, there also voltage is varying at every point in like transformer or any other high voltage equipment, voltage is varying. But when we did electrostatic analysis, we did analysis at the peak of the voltage. That is why we did it as a electrostatic analysis. But we have to remember that actually the voltage also is time varying there. But we are actually we calculated electrostatic fields assuming peak voltage difference between given two electrodes, right. But here actually when we are interested, for example, in eddy currents and all that, we have to take induction effects. If you have to take induction effects, we have to take into account time in transient case or frequency in time harmonic case when all the quantities are sinusoidal, right. So right now what we are going to see is, we are going to see time harmonic case, that means all quantities are sinusoidal. Effectively what you are assuming is all the materials in given problem domain are linear. That means suppose you are applying voltage, right, B will be sinusoidal. Now if magnetic material you are assuming as linear, H and I will be also sinusoidal, right. So there are no harmonics, right. So even if there are
harmonics in excitation,
that means but if the material is linear, then what you could do is, for each harmonic case you could use this formulation and then combine the effects. But linearity is important, is it clear, right. So now let us get into this diffusion equation. So this we have already seen, is it not? When we saw the basics, we have seen this equation, right. So this represents the induced effect, sigma dA by dt, and in fact dA by dt is what, now let us see here, this is a unit of J0, current density. So this also has to be current density. So dabba A by dabba T is E, sigma into E is again J, is it not? So this unit wise or variable wise it is matching. So sigma dA by dt is the induced eddy current density. Sigma times E, dabba A by dabba T is induced electric field intensity. This we have seen earlier, is it not, in basics, right. So now this is in time domain. In frequency domain, D by dabba by dabba T gets replaced by J omega, right. And now again the functional, this also we have seen. When we derived the functional, we started first with Laplace equation, then we derived for the Poisson's equation, and then we there also wrote the expressions of functional for diffusion equation, if you remember. And here the logic is simple. I mentioned to you, you take this term on the right hand side, and whatever is that sign, that comes here in the functional expression, right. So this term when goes on this side, it is plus, and here A is there, so here you get A square. J0 is alone here, so J0 gets multiplied with A. This is by sort of inspection or by intuition, this rule I am telling you, right. But you can actually derive this functional using the procedure that we have seen earlier, is it not? You can derive functional for any PDE including this diffusion equation. And here half comes for these two terms because there is a square term here. Again, that is the rule that I told you earlier. So whenever there is square term in the functional, you will get half multiplied. And here there is only A, there is no half here. So this is the expression for the functional. Now this functional is in general for the whole domain. Now if we discretize using FEM procedure, then we will get this entire whole expression for f. This is summation over all elements, right? Because we are discretizing the whole domain, so it is summation over all elements. And then we know this del square del a square
will result into 9 terms,
is it not? And the corresponding element coefficient matrix, which will have 9 entries, del n I dot del n j. So this actually basically follows from this when you discretize and follow the FEM procedure. So this basically, these two summations and this whole term will give you, or this bracketed term will give you the corresponding elements of the entries of the element coefficient matrix multiplied by a and a j, right? And when we actually minimize one of these ais or ajs will go, then what will remain is c, that one entry of c, small e, c into the corresponding potential, is it not? So that is your, in the final set of equation you have c a is equal to b, is it not? So are you getting? So I am again repeating, this energy, this bracketed term is going to give you the element coefficient matrix one entry. If I is 1, j is also 1, this will give you c 1 1, and then if it is 1, I is equal to 1, this will be a 1, this will be also a 1. Now when we minimize, we will basically differentiate with respect to a 1, so 1 a 1 will go. So that is why then this will remain like c small c 1 1 into corresponding a 1 in the final linear system of equations. We have seen this number of times, but just to again bring to your notice, I am repeating. Then this third term also is similar, exactly identical. In fact, there is no change here, right? So this eventually will result into j delta by 3 for the linear elements, is it not? And those will get apportioned to nodes 1, 2, 3. Now here remember again, this we are using now linear elements here, not quadratic, right? And then what is new here is only this term, because this first term and last term, they were there in Poisson's equation also. What is new here is only this second term, which has, you know, frequency there. So that actually, if you substitute in terms of a, you have, you know, a square. So you will get this, because in place of a, you will substitute that summation, you know, ni ai, is it not? And I goes from 1 to 3. So then you will get this, right, when you substitute it here. So again here, as is just explained here, you have basically a as ae, a superscript e is n1 a1 e plus n2 a2 e plus n3 a3 e, square of that, you will get 9 terms, and those 9 terms basically will be 2 summations. Now again the same formula. Now again we are going back to n1 n2 n3 here, because it is a linear element, and n1 is nothing but capital L1, n2 is capital L2, and n3 is capital L3. Right, and that is why we are using, again going back to the same old formula in terms of n's, because it is a linear element, first order element, right. So now actually the as I said, this first term and third term are same as earlier, so we are only concentrating on this second term. So now here you have product of ni and nj, so product of ni nj dx dy, right. So now here it is ni nj, na? So it is raised to 1 and raised to 1. So that means small l is 1, small m is 1, n is 0. So 1 factorial, 0 factorial, 0 factorial anyway is 1, divided by 1 plus 1 plus 0 plus 2 factorial. So it is 4 factorial into 2 delta, right. So this comes as delta by 12, where delta is the area of the element. So off diagonal entries will be delta by 12. Diagonal entries will be when I is equal to j, this will reduce to n I square. So n I square means small l is 2 and m and n are 0. So it will be 2 factorial divided by 2 plus 0 plus 0 plus 2 factorial. So it will be again 2 factorial upon 4 factorial into 2 times delta. So that gives you delta by 6. So these are the diagonal entries. So the element level matrix equation after minimizing the functional will be this. So now this C times A and B, they are same as in Poisson's equation. So here just note that this A vector and this B vector are enclosed in curly brackets, just to remind ourselves that these are column vectors. Those column vectors are generally written in curly brackets, right. So now this D, so j omega A e, so this n I n j, we have got this diagonal and off diagonal entries, is it not? And then only one A appears, because as I mentioned to you earlier, after minimization this one of these AIs will go, is it not? So only one A will remain after minimization, because we will be differentiating with respect to AIs, is it not? So one A will remain, so that is this one A is remaining here. And then this D matrix is this, diagonal entries are delta by 6, so delta by 12 is taken common. So it is diagonal elements are delta by 6, off diagonal elements are delta by 12 into sigma, there is a sigma here, and of course j omega is there anyway. So now this is our equation, right. So what, as compared to Poisson's equation, what is new here is only this. Now we have to remember that this A is actually phasor, because now we are in frequency domain. So this A is phasor, so is this B, because B is, say, is a function of J, each of these entries is some function of J, is it not? So J also is, current density also is a phasor, is it not? And so this whole thing is in a phasor form. Entries of C, capital C and capital B are same as earlier, right. So now what we do is, to bring it to the same form as CA is equal to B final expression, we can combine this capital CE plus J omega DE as C complex. This capital C and this small c stands for complex, right. So capital CC is equal to capital CE plus J omega DE, and then you finally get this expression just becomes C, because we are now combining these two matrices. So then it is CCEA is equal to B. So what is unknown here is magnetic vector potential, right. Now this is at the element level. Now actually we have to combine all the elements, and then by the usual procedure of formation of global matrices, then we would get only this capital A for the whole domain, capital B, only B, not BE, because this element level, capital B and capital C, small c, for the, that is the global, by our normal procedure of combining element level coefficient matrices to form global matrices. Once we do that, then we actually just take the inverse of this matrix CC global, and then we will get the unknowns is. Before that, you may have to also apply the boundary conditions. Remember, this B is only coming from J, is it not? So, only the source is being represented now here. There could be a boundary, of course, there will be boundary in case of finite element method. So, then you have to impose boundary condition somewhere A is will be 0 on the on some boundary. So, those also have to be imposed, and then finally, you can solve this global equation in terms of C, A and B, right. Now, what we will do is, we will quickly the two points which I did not cover in basics of electromagnetics, we will cover now, which are very important for you know, time harmonic analysis, and is in general you know, we should know. One is complex permittivity and other is complex permeability, right. So, now here these are very simple straightforward derivations starting from Maxwell's equation. So, del cross H is equal to J plus dabba D by dabba T in frequency domain and replacing D by epsilon 0 epsilon R E, you get this, right. Take E common with J replaced by sigma E, right. And then you take J omega epsilon 0 common here. So, you get this straightforward. So, now here we will call this thing as epsilon complex, which is epsilon 0 into epsilon r
minus J sigma over omega epsilon naught.
So, it is basically epsilon dash minus J epsilon double dash. So, the complex permittivity has real component and imaginary component. This imaginary component is representing losses, right, because of this sigma term. If there is a conductivity, finite conductivity for the insulation, see finally what we are considering is complex permittivity will be applicable for example for a capacitor. A practical capacitor will be R and C in parallel, ideal capacitor will be only pure C. Okay. So, if it is ideal capacitor, you will have only epsilon dash. If it is practical capacitor, lossy capacitor, R also will be there, that will then get represented by this epsilon double dash. So, now if we have got this, if the complex permittivity as epsilon dash minus J epsilon double dash, we know for capacitor, we know that I is equal to J omega C V, is it not? J omega C V is the current to the capacitor, because I is equal to V upon 1 upon J omega C, is it not? Is the reactance, capacitive reactance, right. So, I to capacitor is J omega C V, and C is nothing but epsilon A by D. But here epsilon is epsilon dash minus J epsilon double dash, is a complex number, into area, we are denoting area by variable S. So, complex permittivity into area divided by D, right, is the capacitance. So, J omega C V is the current. So, now we substitute this. Here we just we simplify this. So, then this J omega is taken out. So, you get this expression, right. So, this is the final expression. So, now the one common diagnostic term for capacitor is tan delta, which is the real component upon the imaginary, the resistive component and the pure capacitive component of the current. So, IR upon IC, right. So, it is nothing but if you substitute now using this, right. So, then here you will get epsilon double dash upon epsilon dash. So, just see the difference between standard thing here, the lossy component is represented by epsilon double dash, right. And the non-lossy component is represented by epsilon dash, right. and then here the same is represented by this phasor diagram. Here you have IR, IC, and this is the resultant I component, and then here you have theta, and delta is 90 minus theta, right, and tan delta is opposite side upon this side, so IR upon IC, right. So this is the, you know, this complex permittivity. Now where this would be useful, suppose you want to find through finite element method, you want to find out losses in a dielectric, right, then this formulation would be useful. There you have to use complex permittivity and time harmonic analysis. For that you need to know the conductivity of the dielectric. Next is complex permeability. So here you have, we start with V is equal to n d phi by dt, n d phi by dt, B into area is phi, or we call n d psi by dt, because we have been denoting flux by psi, so it is basically n d psi by dt. So now you again d by dt, you make it j omega, and then you rearrange this to get B as this. Then we know H is equal to Ni by L, right, and mu is equal to B by H. Now you substitute in place of B, you substitute this expression, and in case in place of H you substitute Ni by L. So then you call V by I at Z. So why we are doing all this? We are trying to find out equivalent circuit, equivalent, is it not? Here also why did we do all this? Because finally we wanted circuit equivalent, because we basically J omega C V. So here also we are doing the same thing. Okay. So now going further, Z you replace by R plus J omega L. Further you simplify this, then you again you get one real term and one imaginary term, mu dash minus J mu double dash. Right. So here one thing is interesting, you can see here, again I want to bring this point to your notice. Here we have taken V is plus n d psi by dt, so it is a circuit viewpoint, we are not taking minus sign here, we have discussed this in basics, is it not? So that is the reason that V, when we say V is equal to n d psi by dt, V leads psi or B by 90 degrees, is it not? So that is why B or psi is, say if it is like this phasor, B will need by 90 degrees. Now there will be, you know, since we are talking of losses, there will be, you know, I will lag V by some theta, because this is a lossy case. Moment you have got mu double dash, that means it is a lossy magnetic material. That means in corresponding circuit, I will lag V by some angle. So here you will have, so V I cos theta is the corresponding loss. If it is, you know, if it is purely lossless, this angle will be, theta will be 90, and if it is a perfect resistive material, the theta will be 0. Now this, why are we getting this loss? For example, if it is only, we are considering the hysteresis loss. Now hysteresis loss also we have described, is it not? In case of hysteresis phenomena, H leads B by some hysteresis angle theta.
In order to further understand elliptic or complex permeability, let us study this hysteresis curve, original hysteresis curve, given in blue color. Now this is a measured hysteresis loop, and as we know, there is a hysteresis angle between B and H here. So H goes to 0 first at this point, and at this point B goes to 0 when the curve is traversed in anticlockwise direction. Now if we plot B and H with time separately as in this diagram, then and if we force B to be sinusoidal, which can be done during the experimental measurements. So B is forced to be sinusoidal. Then H has to be obviously non-sinusoidal as per this blue hysteresis curve. And in this case, H is having fundamental component as well as harmonics.
Right.
Now this, B and H representation and the corresponding, harmonics in H, this is not amenable for time harmonic formulation, because in time harmonic formulation we have seen all the quantities, field quantities or field variables should be sinusoidal at one frequency. So what we can do is we can neglect the harmonics in H field and consider only its fundamental component. If we do that, then we get H waveform as this and B as original sinusoidal.
Right.
So now both B and H fields are sinusoidal, and now we can use time harmonic formulation, and the corresponding then BH loop becomes as given by orange here. Now this orange curve is having both B and H with their fundamental components only, and the hysteresis angle, although we have neglected harmonics in H, the hysteresis angle here is preserved. So even if we do not have harmonics here in the H waveform, the hysteresis angle here as well as here is same. So we are preserving that. Right. So then with this simplification and the assumption that harmonics in H can be neglected, then both B and H become sinusoidal, and then we get the BH curve as given by orange color, and the corresponding permeability is called as elliptical complex permeability, and the formulation, time harmonic formulation in terms of complex or electrical permeability, which was discussed in the previous slide, can be used, and one can do FEM analysis with this elliptic or complex permeability, and that will be called as frequency domain formulation.
Okay, so we'll stop here and we'll continue the next lecture, and in that we'll continue our discussion on diffusion problems in the next lecture.